من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وخاتم النبيين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الغر الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما والذين يبيتون لربهم سجدا وقياما Respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Last night we started our discussion from the verse number 63 onward, which speaks about 12 major qualities of Ibadur Rahman. 12 major qualities of servants of the Most Merciful. Last night, my apologies, a little bit of a discussion was not so organized. I was terribly busy and I really, I'd like to little bit, not everything, but little bit repeat to get everything in order, inshallah. Few things we mentioned which we a little bit require a bit more clarity and so on, inshallah. I will not discuss the preface of this discussion we have discussed. Why it is mentioned Ibadur Rahman. Ibadur Rahman are mu'mineen, but why Allah calls them Ibadur Rahman? This is number one. Number two, I said Yamshuna alal ardhahuna. That is the first quality of Ibadur Rahman, servants of Allah, servants of Rahman. What is the quality? Quran mentions it like that. That they walk on the earth in humility. Okay, they work, but hauna is not exactly humility. Hauna means slowly, easily, softly, that is the meaning. But indirectly, of course, it refers to walking with humility, without arrogance. Second point in this was that we understand from this first sentence that the first quality of Ibadur Rahman is tawazu. And tawazu means humility. Humility, to be humble, to be in a state of humble. This is the first quality of Ibadur Rahman. Another point quickly we made there that in Quran, amazingly, never word tawazu or directly humility mentioned. Indirectly, you know. In other words, Quran has most of the time mentioned a manifestation of tawazu. Because tawazu is a quality of soul, which I explained last night and we will repeat it quickly tonight again. But Quran does not refer to that quality directly. but rather on different occasions refers to the how this quality manifests itself in action, in attitude and behavior of mu'mineen. وَخْفِضْ خَفْزُ الْجِنَاحِ. Bring your wings down. Now, bring your wings down is expression of, manifestation of humility which is inside you. I made a point last night. So, Quran wants to insist that maybe inside lot of people are not rude and arrogant. No, they are. They humble. They don't think of themselves. They are someone. But they don't express this humility. No, no, you must express it. This quality should be manifested in your attitude. That was the point. I also said Yamshuna means walking on the earth. But Yamshuna comes from Mashi. And Mashi is not just walking. It is lifestyle. So they don't just walk humbly. Their lifestyle is humble lifestyle. Their lifestyle is lifestyle of humility, down to earth people. Okay, and then he spoke quickly, if you remember, the meaning of tawazu. Tawazu comes from waza. Waza means to drop. Waza means to drop. Rafa means to raise. Rafa means to raise. Waza means to drop. Waza means to drop. Tawazu means when you drop yourself before someone else. When you bring yourself down before someone else. Now that humbleness, humility, being down to earth, that is tawazu. And I say, then the next discussion came. Quickly I am making these points which we discussed last night. Why first quality of Ibadur Rahman is tawazu? I explained last night because humility has a close relationship with ubudiyat. Ibadur Rahman means what? Servants of Rahman. And servitude is always with humility. You cannot be servant and you are not humble. So direct consequence of being servant is that you must be humble. You must be down to earth. Similarly, I mentioned that tawazu has a close relationship with ibadat, with ubudiyat and with ibadat. Ubudiyat means slavery, servitude, which we have spoken on a number of occasions. Maqamul ubudiyat, the status of being servant of Allah, which is the highest status in Irfan. It requires first condition is ubudiyat. First condition is tawazu. Ibadat means worship. And in worship also, basically, ruh and spirit and core of ibadat is humbleness. That is another important point. Next point, which is more close, you know, ibadat and ubudiyat, and these things are so close and so important that in Bihar al-Anwar, Allah Majlisi has narrated an amazing hadith. He says that Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to our Nabi option. You want nabuwat with kingship or you want nabuwat with servitude? Which one you want? You want to be a king and a Nabi or you want to be a servant and Nabi? Prophet selected to be Nabi and servant, or servant and Nabi, Abd and Nabi, not king. Prophet never liked to be king. Allah. Then last night, quickly I am just repeating, and inshallah we will discuss tonight a little bit further, three phases of tawazu and humility. Three phases. Number one, the most important one, that we are supposed to be humble before Allah. Humility before our Creator. to be humble before Allah. That is crucial. That is extremely important. I will not repeat. We already discussed and spoken about it last night. But little bit will be before that, if you remember. The point we made there, you must remember, that's a very important point. And I quickly mentioned here that tawazu and humility and being humble is very much connected to marifat. To your comprehension, to your knowledge. Not knowledge in that sense, real knowledge. So as your ilm increases, your humility increases. Why? Remember, I explained only last night. Because as much as you know your, which ilm we're talking about, I said last night, ilmun nafs and ilmun zat, ilm billah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Knowing yourself and knowing your Lord. When you know yours, as much as you know yourself better, you realize that how nothing you are, how little you are, how dependent you are, how beggar you are before Allah. And as much as your knowledge about Allah increases, you realize what Allah is great and how great is Allah. So as much as you realize greatness of Allah and nothingness of yourself, you become humble and humble and humble. But someone who does not know, someone who does not know who he is, he thinks of himself something, and therefore he is not humble. Therefore, jahil is not humble. Alim is humble. Real alim, as I already mentioned to you last time. One hadith I would like to add in this discussion, you know, and that is very important, one point. And therefore, my brothers, please listen carefully what I am saying. No one can be more humble. No one can be more humble than Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala
Muhammad. And other anbiya, salawatullahi wa salam. And awliya and Ahlulbayt, alayhimussalatu wassalam. Why? Because of the connection of marifat. Bayazid Bustami is a Sufi. He says that every human being is humble according to his marifat of self and his Lord. In other words, level of humbleness in every human being is according to level of his marifat and knowledge about himself and his Lord. More than Bayazid Bustami, I would like to give you a hadith, very beautiful hadith from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam in book by the name of Misbah al-Sharia, which is a very deep book with great spiritual and mystical meanings and messages. In that book, Imam Sadiq says, here he goes very deep, listen carefully what he says, La ya'araf ما في معنى حقيقة التواضع. He said, no one knows what is the meaning of reality and truth of تواضع, means humility, إلا المقربون من عباده. Allahu Akbar. Except those who are close to him from his servants. That's all. And no, he goes, Al-Muttasirina bi-rahdawniyyati. Allahu Akbar. And those who are connected to his unity. Who are connected to his oneness, unity, rahdawniyyah. Allahu Akbar. Anyway, lot of explanation required. Let us move. Second phase of humility is being humble before people, before human being, before insan. Now this humility before human being again has levels, degrees. First level of humility is to be humble before Anbiya, before our Nabi, before Awliya, before Muqarrabeen ila Allah, before Imams and Ahlulbayt alayhim assalatu wassalam. Very important, extremely important. You cannot be arrogant toward Nabi and you think that you can benefit anything. No, no, no way, no way. Allah, I don't want to go in detail, there was a lot we can speak. After Anbiya, Awliya, Aimma, comes humility before your parents. Very important to be humble before parents. Quran commands, وَحْفِظْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ, and extend or drop your wings of humility لَهُمَا, for your parents, for your mother and father. Very important. Ibadur Rahman are humble before their parents. They never arrogant before their mother and father. They never raise their voice before father and mother. You know, these ahadiths are amazing. So every aspect which I am discussing can be a topic of its own and not of discussion. What Ahlulbayt taught us, when you are walking in a shopping mall, I don't know, in a street, never walk ahead of your parents, always walk behind. Even that is commanded and recommended. Don't raise your voice. Don't speak to them. Make dua for them. Even if they are not Muslim, still you cannot be rude with them. Still you cannot be arrogant with them. No. You don't have to follow them. Of course you cannot follow them. But you cannot be rude with them. You cannot be arrogant. You cannot look at them. They are nothing. No. But you will speak to them qawlan kareema, a kind, a compassionate word, a humble word. So this is another level of humility. And then, of course, comes to be humble before your teachers, asatid, Allahu Akbar. Another level of humility. Parents, I said, muqarribun, which is Anbiya and Aimma, Ahlulbayt and Awliya, Sulha. Then comes, of course, Walidain. Then comes Asatid, Ulama. Allahu Akbar. Can I take 2-3 minutes of time and tell you? You see, there's a difference between ilm and definition of ilm in secular environment, like universities, and in Islamic environment, difference. In secular environment, ilm is information. You can get it from your teacher, but your relationship with teacher is immaterial, it got nothing to do. You speak to him nicely or no, you treat him nicely or no, you take him serious or no, that's completely immaterial. Because he must give you information and you must grasp and understand that academic information from him. Absorb it. Wassalam, finish. He go his way, you go your way. But when we talk about education and knowledge in Islam, in a spiritual environment, no, my brother, Al-ilmu nurun yakhzifahu Allah fi qalbi man yasha. Ilm is not information. Ilm is light. Ilm is nur, which is enlightened in the heart of those people. Allah wants to enlighten them. And therefore, now if you want to learn that ilm which is nur, you don't just want information. And therefore, one of the major conditions for a student to get something from a student or teacher, to learn something from teacher, these young children also should listen, this is for you also, that you should be humble towards your teacher and ustad. You must have utmost respect for your teacher. Maulana Amir al-Mumin got one amazing sentence. What Maulana Amir al-Mumin said? He said, Man allamani harfan faqad sayyarani abdan. Imam says, Maulana Amir al-Mumin says, who taught me one word, he made me his own slave. You understand what I'm trying to say? Now in our universities like Najaf and Qom, where seminaries, Hawzat al-Ilmiya, we have been taught from day one, you will never succeed. You will never be able to achieve that ilm which is nur, if you are not humble before your teacher. It does not mean that you cannot differ with your teacher. No, you differ with your teacher. You are critical of teacher. Teacher saying day, you are saying night. You are 180 degree different, for example. You fight with your teacher over the academic issues. But at the same time, amazingly, your respect and your humility before teacher, you know, is there. Before is there. Allahu Akbar. For example, I will give you a practical example. Shaheed Ayatullah Muhammad Baqir Sadr Rizwanullahi Ta'ala Alayh. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
This great thinker, this great philosopher, this great academic giant, Allahu Akbar. He was a student of who? Ayatullah al-Uzma Khuyi Rizwanullah ta'ala alayhi. Okay, he was a student of Ayatullah Khuyi. But he has no opinions, very much of course different sometimes than Ayatullah Khuyi Rizwanullah alayhi. You know. Now, when he has his lectures or in his books when he presented his research, naturally he presents opinion of his teacher and then he heavily criticized, for example, in fact, you know, crushes that idea, for example, into pieces. But look how he addresses, you know, when he brings his opinion of the lecturers, how he says, Sayyiduna al-Ustaz wa amma ma qal Sayyiduna al-Ustaz. And my master, Sayyid means master, Mawla. My master, my teacher, my guru, he says so. He does not take name, no. He does not mention name. He says, Sayyiduna al-Ustaz. So we know that in Ayatullah Shahid Sadr books, whenever he used word Sayyiduna al-Ustaz, he is referring to Ayatullah Khuyi. And even now in Qom, if you go, you know, out of respect, sometimes they don't mention name. They mention one of the great scholars says so, and then they analyze, and then they speak. So while they differ, and while they are critical, and while they are analyzing opinion of somebody else critically, at the same time, this humbleness, this respect is amazing. We have two people in Iran, at one time. One was Ayatullah al-Uzma, Asad Ahmad Khunsari, Rizwanullah ta'ala alayhi. And we have Imam Khomeini, Rahmatullah alayhi. Of course, Asad Ahmad al-Khunsari, Ayatullah al-Uzma al-Khunsari, was much more senior by age and so on from Imam. But of course, Imam was Imam Khomeini, leader of revolution, everything. And part of the life of Marhum Asad Ahmad Khunsari, Rahmatullah Alayh, was in the early days of revolution. I'm also really privileged to meet him and make ziyarat of this extremely pious person by the name of Ayatullah Uzma, Asad Ahmad Khunsari. Anyway, you will not believe. Ayatullah Uzma, Asad Ahmad Khunsari, Rizwanullah Alayh, didn't believe in Vilayat-e-Faqih at all. Or believed it in very, very limited. While Imam Khomeini believed in that philosophy of Vilayat-e-Faqih in its biggest span, in its widest span. In other words, now not going without in a technical discussion, not so much interesting for you. He used to believe in Vilayat-e-Faqih that jurist must establish government and he has a responsibility to establish Islamic government and this and that. Ayatullah Khunsari, no, didn't believe. He used to say, no, it's not duty of faqih. Faqih duty, jurist duty is to guide people. Wassalam. What else happens? That's people's job, not ulama's job. 180 degree difference between opinion of these two people. Allahu Akbar. With such a big difference of opinion, amazing, is that when in the early stages of when Imam Khomeini became Marja, or almost becoming Marja after Ayatollah Brujerdi passed away, people were asking him, who you think now is the most learned person we should follow? You know what he said? Ayatollah Khunsari. Someone who differs with him 180 degree in the opinion. This is taqwa of Imam. This is humility of Imam, rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam himself toward Marhum Ashhad Abdul Karim Hamiri, who was his teacher, main teacher, Marhum Ashhad Abdul Karim Hamiri, who the founder of House of Ilmi and Qum, Allahu Akbar, amazing humility we find. And I can tell you and I can speak about it whole night that how humility and humbleness and being down to earth before teacher and ustad plays an important role. If you want to learn something from someone, you need to be humble before that person. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Now, after teachers and asatid and ulama, then comes another level quickly, level of tawazzu and humility, and that is humility before mu'mineen, before all the other people, mu'mineen and muslimin. It is, in other words, not you have to be humble before big people, big ulama, and pious people. No, even toward normal mu'mineen also you are supposed to be humble. How important is this? That Allah commands to His Nabi himself. What He says? وَخْفِزْ جَنَانَكَ لِمَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Bring your wing down. Bring it down. For who? For those who follow you from mu'mineen. Allahu Akbar. Now just imagine. If Prophet is commanded to be humble before his followers, then what about us toward each other? I don't have to give any explanation about that. And this is the verse which I was trying to recall last night and couldn't, in Surah Luqman, when Luqman commands to his son, وَلَا تُسَئِرْ خَدَّكَ لِلنَّاسِ. Don't make your face for the people. Don't. Pull it like that. وَلَا تَمْشِي فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرْحًا. And don't speak, walk on the earth with arrogance. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلُّ مُخْتَالٍ. فَخُورَ. That is Surah Furqan, Surah Luqman, verse number 8. Let me move. You know, one day, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you see, too much to talk. One of the things repeatedly, not once, repeatedly reported about our Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam is this, that when a stranger used to come to Medina, and now they don't know who is Prophet and where is Prophet. They used to walk in the streets and then they go in a gathering in a masjid or somewhere, people are sitting. So he used to, these strangers used to get into that gathering and he used to look around and say, we came here looking for Muhammad. Where is Muhammad? Why? Because he never used to sit in a manner which makes him outstanding completely from others. You know, he's sitting on the high position, others are sitting low, and he is in a particular dress or a particular style. Like nowadays, we are used to these type of things so much. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Never. Who is Muhammad? Is it Muhammad? Yeah. But that Muhammad who claims to be last prophet of Allah. He said, yes, he is. He said, but he look like anybody else here. He said, but this is the quality of being Nabi. Salawat ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
One day, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting on sand itself, with number of slaves, very dirty probably they were also. And he was probably busy eating with something with them or talking with them something. And there a woman passed from, you know, some respectful woman, in other words, some madam, some lady, she passed there. She looked at this situation, Muslim she was, and she said, oh Muhammad, why are you sitting on sand? Why are you sitting on the ground? And you are became fellow of, you know, companion of these slaves, and you are eating along with them. That's not appropriate. That's not suitable for a Nabi to sit and mix with these people. This is not right. That you should sit with, you know, slaves. She used the word. It's not suitable to sit and eat with slaves on ground for you as a Nabi. You must have some sort of a protocol. Protocol. You know what Prophet replied? That's a beautiful sentence. He said, Vayhaki, ayyu abdin a'abadu minni. What are you talking about? What are you talking about, a woman? Who can be more servant than me? Allahu Akbar. Did you understand? Who can be, you are saying that I'm sitting among the slaves. Who can be more slave than myself? Now he referred to another slave, slavery of Allah, maqam al-ubudiyyah. The kamal and climax of the Prophet is Ashhadu anna Muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. First abd, then rasul, my brother. Ubudiyyat. Servitude, being servant. He said, what are you talking about? Why am I sitting among servants? Why am I sitting among slaves? Who can be more slave than me in this world? This is akhlaq of our Nabi and Rasul alayhi salatu. As-salam, salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Brothers, now left one, there's still a lot of discussions, but to finish, one very important point I need to discuss here. Any quality, any akhlaqi quality, you take it. Any moral attribute, you take it. Got two extremes, too much, too little, and middle path. Too much is not good, too too little is also not good. Balance is correct. Middle path is the right. So when it comes to humility, also remember, arrogance, rudeness, bragging, showing off that you are someone, thinking that you are above everybody, others are nothing, is bad, is the worst enemy of Iman. I already explained last night and tonight. But at the same time, if humility go to other extreme, also problem, because that humility becomes humiliation. I don't know English is right or not, but humility is something, humiliation is something else. Allah wants from all of you to be humble, but Allah does not want you to be humiliated, submissive. No. You must understand, very important point, please. I need your attention for 2-3 minutes, I'll come to it. I am repeatedly saying that Ibadur Rahman are humble. Why? Because of the Ma'rifat. Because they know who they are. And they know who is Allah. Right? Therefore they are humble. But sometimes you are humble not because of Ma'rifat, but because of weakness. You are humble because you are weak. If you were powerful, you wouldn't have recorded anybody anything. You would have drove over everybody. Today, because you drive a 30 years old car with no brakes and tires which are 100 times punctured, so you drive very soft. But if a four-wheel drive, a brand new, is given to your hand, you won't see even who is in front of you. So this is not humbleness. Humbleness which comes out of weakness is not humbleness. Humbleness which comes out of fear, because there is a traffic cop standing there, therefore you drive so nicely. This is not humility. This is weakness. Amirul Mu'mineen said beautifully, Thuba liman thawala, good luck, blessed are those who are humble, not because of any shortcoming. Allah. Kalamul Imam, Imamul Kalam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali.
Blessed are those who are humble, not out of shortcoming, not out of weakness, not out of fear. No. Out of ma'rifat, out of this quality which is inside themselves. Those are humble. That is real humility. Allahu Akbar. Therefore, brothers and sisters, sometimes we need to be arrogant also. Not always dumb. Sometimes we need to be not arrogant, but we need to be powerful. We need to be showing that we are confident. In other words, sometimes humbleness does not mean to show that you are out of confidence. Like you're bragging, you're begging, and you believe you are nothing. Sometimes, as I said, it's because of fear, because of weakness, and sometimes maybe intention is good, but not understanding, you know, the modest concept of humility. You overdo it. Now in front of other people you become so low that you are a beggar, and you... Allah does not like a moment to insult himself. Tahqeer and tazleel of nafs, not acceptable in Islam. You're not supposed to make yourself humiliated. No, you must have self-respect. See, these things must be balanced. Humility must be there, but self-respect must not be compromised. Must not be. And as I mentioned just now, sometimes even little bit expression of power, confidence, independence is also necessary, especially when you are in front of enemy. Then you don't have to be humble. There is a Sahabi by the name of Abu Dajjani Ansari in the battle of Uhud. He was walking like that. Like a big deal in front of Kufar. Okay? Now what happened? Prophet did not condemn him. Prophet praised him. He said, Mashallah, you're walking in front of enemies of Deen with confidence. And similarly, Prophet warned very much clearly that if you become humble, Allahu Akbar, before a rich guy due to his wealth, Allahu Akbar, you have prepared azab for yourself. So if someone becomes humble before someone who is rich due to his wealth, it's a problem. In fact, hadith says other way. Hadith says that if a rich guy became humble, shows himself humble before a poor guy, before someone who has nothing, rafa'ahu Allah, he brings him down, Allah takes him up. Yawm
al-Qiyamah.
Hadith says that if someone who comes to a rich guy, Zama Saratan, someone who got resources, Fataksha, he becomes humble with the hope that he will give him something what he got, which he will never give by the way. But anyway, with the hope. But he said, Zahaba Sulsadinhi, he will lose 2/3 of his religion. He will lose, you know, 2/3 of his religion. Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam said, Wama akbahu bil mu'min antakuno lahu raghbatun. This is the point. Imam Sadiq, how ugly is that believer who got a desire, for that desire he is ready to be humiliated, to be insulted. To fulfill that desire, he is ready to be humiliated. May Allah protect us. May Allah guide us. You know, and therefore, so many things Islam does not like. Yunus ibn, yes, Yaqub says that I said to my master, Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, Imam, give me your hand, I want to kiss. Imam allowed him to kiss. Then he said, please Imam, let me kiss on your forehead. Imam allowed him to kiss. Then he said, Imam, I want to kiss your feet. Imam said, no, that is sufficient. Yeah. Imam does not want you to be, you know, someone with no respect. You know, no. So this is very, very important, inshallah, brothers and sisters. With one hadith from Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, I will conclude this discussion. Man tawaza'a rafa'ahu Allah. Beautiful hadith. Prophet says, someone who is humble, Allah means, as I said, tawaza means who brings himself down. Someone who brings himself down, Allah raises him up. وَهُوَ فِي نَفْسِهِ زَعِيفٌ. Before himself, he thinks he is weak, he is nothing. وَفِي أَعْيُنِ النَّاسِ عَظِيمٌ. But in the eyes of people, he is great. In the eyes of the people, he is indeed great. This is the benefit of being humble. But with this balance and this warning, which I gave in the last part of our discussion tonight. Tomorrow we will, inshallah, speak about the second quality of Ibadur Rahman, which is very, very beautiful and important, where Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ibadur Rahman, الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. And when ignorant addresses them, they say peace. What quality is referred here? Tomorrow night, inshallah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa